So let's talk about vibrations. There are lots of things around us that cause vibrations in the air all the time, and we're really sensitive to these tiny, minuscule differences in air pressure because those little ups and downs are what we mentally experience as sound. When we talk, we're making it happen, the air from our lungs pressuring the world around us, but we don't always vibrate the same way. I'm Moti Lieberman, and this is the Ling Space.
Welcome to the Ling Space.
So in earlier episodes, when we talked about how to define speech sounds, we noted that one of the things we pay attention to when we're listening is if our vocal folds are vibrating or not. If they're vibrating, we get a voice sound with some buzz to it, like a vv. But if they're not vibrating, then we get a voiceless sound that's notably quieter, like a f. Everything else about these sounds is the same. It's just a question of whether they have that underlying vibration that makes us hear them differently. Whenever we talk, we press air out from our lungs, through our larynx, then through all the minute manipulations of our vocal tract to shape the wave we're producing. And it's true when we look across languages, voice sounds versus voiceless is the most common way we deal with phonation, or the act of producing sounds. But as it turns out, there are a couple more settings humans can use in creating the vibrations that hit our conversation partner's eardrums. Instead of a binary choice, we should think of voicing as more of a range of how free the path is to get that air out into the world. So at one end of the range, your glottis is just 100% closed and no air goes through. That's a glottal stop, but that's about it. We can't use it beyond that for speech because, well, the passage of air is important for speaking. It sort of is speaking. But that's one extreme. At the other extreme, there's zero closure at all. Your vocal folds are just at 100% open, and the air calmly and blissfully flows through to your waiting mouth and nose. That open state is what we experience as a voiceless sound. Free flow through the larynx means no vibrations, and no vibrations means no voicing.
So, what is voicing?
Well, it's what we get when we set our vocal folds closed, but then we start blowing up air from our lungs behind them anyway. Before long, the pressure below our larynx gets too great, and the vocal folds are pushed apart. But the air suddenly rushing through the gap creates suction due to the Bernoulli effect, and the vocal folds quickly get pulled shut once again, only to get blasted apart once more. This voicing cycle of blowing apart and whooshing back together is what creates the buzz we can hear and feel in voice sounds like zzzz or mmm. Okay, so far we've covered three vocal fold positions. No airflow, open with free airflow, and regular voicing, where the air gets released cyclically. So we can basically list these in terms of openness of airflow like this. When we do that, we see there are two other possibilities in between the other positions we've talked about. One is that we could produce sounds where the air can get out, but not as easily as with normal voicing. And the other is that we can make sounds that let out more air than regular voicing, but still not as freely as if it were voiceless. And it turns out human language uses both of these possibilities. We'll do just about anything with our vocal folds that we can figure out how to do. Let's take a look at the more open of these first. What can we do with our larynx to make everything looser? Well, we can just not quite close the vocal folds completely when we're doing our voicing thing. Since the whole time you're talking, you're blowing up air from your lungs, as long as there's some opening, that air will keep escaping. So if you don't quite close the vocal folds, then on top of the regular wave that's getting produced from the vibration, there's just some extra air that'll make it out too. This airflow gives these sounds a characteristic breathy quality, so speech produced this way is said to have breathy voice. Because breathy voice happens on top of the way that we make voice sounds, we can potentially produce any kind of voice sound in any language with it. If you want to write out breathy voice, you can use two little dots under the sound, like for ah or e. But it's not just for vowels, it's also nasal sounds like hmm, or approximants like er. Even voice stops can have a breathy voice associated with them, like buh or duh. Breathy voice isn't super common in English, although there is one place where we can sometimes find it, and it's with putting an H between vowels. Try it yourself. Try putting your hands over your ears and then saying a word like ahead. You'll feel the vibration carry through the whole time that you're saying the huh, but that doesn't really make sense since huh can't be voiced itself. Huh is a glottal fricative, so voicing it would be asking your vocal folds to do two things at the same time. Instead, you're getting breathy voice. You get huh.
But even if
breathy voice isn't common in English, you can still find a solid bunch of languages, particularly South Asian ones, that use it to differentiate between words. Like, for example, Hindi has bal with the regular b, which means hair, but also has bal with the breathy b, which means forehead. Or look at Newari, a language spoken in Nepal and India. There, na means it melts, but na means need. So that change in how we do our voicing really can cause a meaningful difference.
So that's what happens
when we let through more air when we're voicing. What if we let through less? We can tighten up our vocal folds, making it harder for them to vibrate
normally.
Like, we can keep the back part of the vocal folds closed completely, and the front part will only vibrate slower because it'll take
more effort
for the air to come out. This makes your voice sound like it has a lower pitch, because slower vibrations means that it sounds lower. But doing this also makes it sound like this, and so it's also known as creaky voice. Much like with breathy voice, creaky voice can be applied to any sound that's usually voiced. And we also mark it under the sound, here with a tilde, so like rrr, or oo, or zzz. Using creaky voice to distinguish between meanings is also not super common cross-linguistically, but it does happen. For instance, we can find creaky
voice in Danish,
where the regular versus creaky difference
at the end of the word
changes the meaning.
So a word like ben means beans, but ben means peasants.
Or du means you, but du means tablecloth.
And we can even find languages that
have both breathy and creaky voice, like in the Mazatec languages spoken in Mexico. There, nda means buttocks, but nda means horse. Of course, even if a language doesn't use breathy and creaky voice to cause a change in the meaning of its words, that doesn't mean that we don't use it at all. Both of these phonation types show up in all languages to mark social cues or just in different phonological environments. It's too handy of a tool for making a sound different to ignore. In English in particular, you may have run into creaky voice lately. It's very common in the
speech of young women,
and it's been demonized as sounding grating or annoying or even being damaging to the vocal folds. But of course, that's just not true. That'd suggest that for all these languages with creaky voice, people are just going to wear out their vocal
folds
over the years. Copenhagen isn't full of people forced to whisper because they've creaked their voices away. And everyone uses creaky voice some of the time. It's particularly common in English at the end of declarative sentences, where our pitch goes down. Now that you know what it is, if you listen for it, you probably won't have to wait long before you find it in your own speech. The treatment of creaky voice in English is just another shot at how young women speak, like how the use of like used to be attacked. There's nothing inherently bad about it. Personally, I think it sounds cool. However you feel about breathy or creaky voice, they both represent different ways of producing part of the expansive range of sounds that humans use for speech. Sometimes it's to differentiate between words, and sometimes it's a social cue. We play our larynxes like virtuosos, voicing and creaking and just letting the air flow out. But any way you do it, human speech makes for a lot of good vibrations.
So we've reached the end of the Ling space for this week.
If you let our speech waves impinge on your eardrums, you learn that there's more to voicing than just voiced versus voiceless. That we can allow more air out along with our vibrations and get breathy voice. That we can tighten up our vocal folds and make ourselves sound all creaky. And that even if it's rare for languages
to use these forms to change meanings,
breathy and creaky voice are really common within languages as social cues or allophones. The Ling Space is produced by me, Moti Lieberman. It's directed by Delelise Prévost, and it's written by both of us. Our editor is Georges Coulombe, our production assistant is Stéphane Hurtubise, our music is by Shane Turner, and our graphics team is Atelier Muse. We're down in the comments below, or you can bring the discussion back over to our website where we'll have some extra material on this topic. Also, try dropping by our new store, where we have a bunch of cool linguistic stuff. Check us out on Tumblr, Twitter, and Facebook. And if you want to keep expanding your own personal Ling space, please subscribe. And we'll see you next Wednesday. Hot see again.